Dr. Coffey came to UCF in 2002 as an associate professor in MMAE. Today, he's a professor in the MSE department. In fact, he served as the first interim chair of the MSE department following its formation in 2012, and previously as the graduate coordinator for the interdisciplinary MSE program.
Actually, I'm not.
You were.
I were.
You were, yeah. Dr. Coffey holds degrees from New College of Florida, FIU, Northeastern, and MIT. He's held industrial positions at Saxon Copystatics, Nashua Corporation, Sensormatic Electronics Corporation, Seagate Technology, and IBM. His research interests include thin film processing and magnetic materials, among other things. I can recite a long list of accomplishments, but you didn't come here to listen to me. You came here to see Dr. Coffey. So I would just prefer to give him the opportunity to talk about himself and his vision for the MSE department. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Kevin Coffey.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Okay, I'm Kevin Coffey, as you know. The search committee asked me to cover three things in my presentation today. My vision for MSE, and I'll start off with a disclaimer. MSE needs to have a vision from MSE, but we're just going to get my vision today. And I'll speak briefly about my career and research highlights, and then have time for audience questions. My vision for MSE necessarily follows UCF's vision for UCF, and that is most succinctly described in the recent 2016 Collective Impact Strategic Plan that's been approved by USCF's Board of Trustees. You can find this at UCF's website at your leisure. The goals for UCF in this plan are unchanged. The five key goals that guide us, these, I think, what, 25 years ago, Dr. Hitt put these in place, to offer the best undergraduate education available in Florida, to achieve international prominence in key programs of graduate study and research, to provide an international focus to our curricula and research programs, to become more inclusive and diverse, and to become America's leading partnership university. So nothing new on the goals, but there is something new in the vision that I would want to make sure I share with you guys. Sort of the strategy on how we're going to do things. It's probably, we've been doing it like this for 5 or 10 or more years, but this is actually the first time that I saw it in writing. Was the whole idea is that we're going to leverage scale to excellence. So if I tell you that UCF is a really, really big university, you know that. You know, we used to claim number two in the country. Now I think we're just saying one of the largest. But what we want is impact, locally, nationally, internationally. So the vision is to leverage scale to excellence, and scale and excellence will give us the impact we need, right? So that's where we want to go as a university. That also appears to be the college's vision, the college that we're in. You can find online the goals for our college, and they're exactly the same as the UCF goals. Also, we see online that college is leveraging scale to excellence. You know, most recently achieved, Dr. Georgiopoulos, that can be credited, achieved 46 among public universities in the U.S. News and World Report ranking. That's a big deal. You know, the article that describes this makes the point that engineering in particular uses the power of scale to produce excellence. So this is our strategy throughout the university, is not just be good, but to be good and excellent. And being good helps you be excellent. They don't let high school football teams from high schools with 500 students play against high school football teams from high schools with 5,000 students. It's not a fair fight. Being large helps you be excellent. And we need to leverage that and use that deliberately. The other thing sort of around the world that MSE is in is preeminence. Preeminence is a term commonly used to describe the preferential state funding for the University of Florida and Florida State University. Obviously, we want to break into that club, right? We want all the preferential funding for UCF equal to that of UF and FSU. Recently, House Bill 729 established emerging preeminent state research universities with 12 metrics. So they're actually putting quantitative measures on what we need to do to move up and get to that bar. So this is from UCF's five-year emerging preeminence plan. Table one here on this side is metrics that we've already achieved, and this was as of 2016. So average GPA and SAT score, six-year graduation rate, non-medical science and engineering research expenditures, national ranking in STEM research expenditures in top 100 in 5 out of 8 disciplines, patents awarded over 3 years, doctoral degrees awarded annually. We got those. Table 2 is the ones we don't have, with exception of this, which we now have. Okay, we recently had 6 members of the National Academy join UCF and change their home university designation to UCF. So that one's a done deal. But these others, we need to work on them. Public university national ranking, freshman retention rate, science and engineering research expenditures. This one includes medical. This one does not. And the question is our medical school going to come up with the missing $50 million in time? I don't think so. Medical school is building a teaching hospital. That's what they're moving forward with, and that's going to allow them to make that type of contribution to our research expenditures, but that's not going to happen by 2021. So we need to be working on that. Number of postdoctoral appointees, that's where we really look bad. We're not hiring postdocs. We need to be hiring postdocs. Endowment size, that one we'll probably not make, but we don't need to make them all. Okay, so the ones that I think material science and engineering can focus on is helping out in the national rankings, science and engineering research expenditures. You know, even though we're in the non-medical part that's already sort of met its goal, we need to get the total. And a number of postdoctoral appointees, and I'll talk about that. But these are the things that we need to be doing with whatever vision we have for MSC, and specifically my vision for MSC. We need to support these SEEKS and UCF goals. One of the big issues is we don't have an undergraduate program. So it's really hard to be offering the greatest undergraduate education if you don't have an undergraduate program. So that needs to be fixed. We need to support the preeminence measures. And where we stand right now, and I'll show you my data to make the argument, is MSC has more excellence than it has scale. We're not being big trying to drive to excellence. Rather, we're kind of okay on excellence, not so much on scale, but we definitely lack recognition, and I'll talk about that. And sort of some general background that I'll talk about as well is, you know, what is material and science and engineering as a discipline, and sort of MSC here at UCF. So here's the slide that talks about excellence. The National Research Council, so that's the National Academy of Engineering and National Academy of Science. Their most recent report went out in 2010. MSC, doctoral program here at UCF, 35 out of the 83 programs they ranked. That's pretty good. And this is based on solely quantitative measures. This is not a reputation contest. This is a series of numbers. You're welcome to look at the report. So in this, within SEEKS, 35th was the highest absolute ranking of any doctoral program that was ranked. And I say second percentage-wise, just because I'm reinforcing the point that 35 out of 36 is not too good, huh? But 35 out of 350 is. So as a percentage point, so 35 out of 83, we weren't first, we were second. Environmental engineering was first as a doctoral program. Okay. Okay, so that's where I'm claiming that we have excellence. But if we look at this U.S. News and World Reports thing that came out, not so good. We're only 71st, right? This is based on more recent data, but I don't think that's the issue. I think that this guy includes measures of reputation. They're doing things like sending survey instruments out to high school guidance counselors. High school guidance counselors have never heard of you if you don't have an undergraduate program. Okay, they should not like you. So, as well as other measures of reputation, right? So, that's where we're really doing badly. Where Seeks was 46, moving up, a good accomplishment. The argument is that we are not helping. As 71st, we're actually at the bottom of the Seeks pile. Okay. So I can claim that we're quantitatively have excellence, but in terms of recognition, reputation, nothing. Okay, so we need to do something about that, and so that's really where we need to go. But let me finish talking about scale. So this is a survey. This results from a 2012 survey done by the Materials Research Society in conjunction with the University Materials Council. For those not familiar with it, the UMC is the Organization of Material Science Departments, where they share information on shared list of graduating students looking for doctoral programs, etc. And have been a member, but I don't think we've been active because we don't have an undergraduate program. So. You know, this is the largest, the Ohio State University, with 30 faculty. And you can see that generally there's a whole lot more fulls than assistants, which is also characteristic of us. But just in terms of scale, we're down there. We're not one of the biggest. We're down there amongst the smallest. The 10 people we have right now actually includes two full-time directors, Dr. Seal and Dr. Fenton, who don't even teach in the department. So maybe we really have a head count of 8, how you want to choose it. But we don't have scale. So that kind of makes things difficult for us. The other thing that I want to talk about material science's background is that it's not a typical discipline. The point I'm going to make here is that we're an interdisciplinary discipline. This is data from a ranking by Thomson Reuters of the top 100 chemists in the world during 2000 to 2010, for over a decade. I show here the top 15, and I actually look them up to find out what they got their PhD in. Not surprisingly, chemists got PhD in chemistry or physical chemistry, okay, things of that nature. If we look at the same thing for material science, so this is the top 100 material scientists. I'm listing here the top 15. I looked up their doctoral fields. There are some material scientists there. But there's a whole lot of people not anywhere in the College of Engineering at all, physics, chemistry. This is the nature of material science as a discipline. It's an interdisciplinary discipline in terms of the people that are doing the research. But let me talk a little bit more. What about the people that are faculty, that are doing the teaching? So again, I'm contrasting a typical program. This is 2012 data, mechanical engineering faculty. And this is that NRC ranking. So University of Michigan is a top mechanical engineering program. And this was Wayne State University, a lower-ranked program, UCF, Texas A&M, and we can see that basically the faculty in mechanical engineering programs are mostly mechanical engineers. We have some here at a top-ranked program, perhaps 10 out of a total of 50 that are in other engineering disciplines. But relatively few that are outside of engineering in the College of Science. If we contrast that to material science programs, it's a different story. We get now to the top here, MIT, Northwestern. very highly ranked. They do have more material science and engineering PhDs than others, but just barely. And they've got 40 to 50% are outside the material science and engineering. And some are in other engineering disciplines, but actually they're mostly in the College of Science. So these are the tenure home faculty in these departments. This is not the secondary joints, right? These are the core faculty. So UCF today, if I put in UCF data and I include Dr. Kushima, who has a doctorate in mechanical engineering, who will be here in May. This has to, of course, exclude Surya and Nina. They're no longer with us in materials. We're sort of okay here, but we're still not there. So just in terms of recruiting, we should not be afraid of material scientist people who have PhDs in chemistry or physics. Bringing some of those into the program would actually make us look more like the top programs. That's kind of where we need to go. So my vision for MSE is that we have to pursue scale, excellence, and recognition. These are the key things that we need to be doing. Just as for the whole university, scale and excellence is going to give us that impact. And what we want out of that impact is recognition and meeting and helping UCF with these preeminence metrics. So let's talk about scale. This is older data again, 2009-2012, where I'm comparing the undergraduate population at University of Florida and their master's program and their PhD program. That's all in red. And then the blue here was UCF. And the main thing I want you to take from this slide is it's going like that. It's flowing. And we expect that. If you have a bunch of undergraduates, some of them are going to stay for masters. If you have a lot of masters, some of them are going to stay for PhDs. Okay. And but UCF is going the other way. And actually, if we look at more recent data, and this is from the MSE webpage, it's actually worse. We've increased our PhD enrollment a little bit. Say 42 to 47, but we're down to sort of 4 and 7 master's students, right? So the point I'm making here is that in achieving scale, an undergraduate program that, and this is hypothetical, let's say we had half the students at the University of Florida did 4 or 5 years from now, that's gonna help us greatly across the board. The other thing about an undergraduate program is it's an opportunity for recognition in many ways. We'll have undergraduates going to Northwestern, to MIT, to these top programs. Right now we have no undergraduates to share with them. We'll be interacting with those programs. Why? Because we'll be sharing information in the University Materials Council, the UMC. Right now we can't really play in that field. We don't have a program. So scale for students is going to be keyed on an undergraduate program and, of course, increasing research dollars. That's how we fund our PhD students. Scale for faculty really is going to be dependent on the cluster initiative and us taking advantage of that fully, much more so than we have so far. MSE, I've made the point that we're an interdisciplinary discipline. We are uniquely positioned to benefit from this cluster initiative strategy. This should be, in terms of our faculty numbers, manna from heaven. It's a gift out of nowhere. And we should be actively participating across the board, seeking to establish and participate in new clusters, and these efforts need to be led by the chair. That's a chair leadership job, okay? He's not in control of it, no. But he needs to lead and provide energy into that. Excellence. Let's talk about excellence. The whole function of leadership is to make a department greater than the sum of its faculty. That's it in a nutshell. You could talk about this for days and hours, but that's what it does. And you can't do that part-time. That requires a full-time person committed to that as a job. That's what a chair is, right? Making the department more than the sum of its faculty. Faculty interacting and working together, teaching, research, service, that is so key. I did a minor in the management of technology when I was doing my PhD at MIT in the Sloan School of Business. And you can imagine, at MIT, the Sloan School of Business, they're going to do everything they can to come out with what are the predictive elements by which we can decide how to increase research productivity. And they were focusing at the time at the major corporate labs, which are basically doing what universities are doing today in terms of the scope. You think about what AT&T Bell Labs was doing 20 years ago. You know, these people were winning Nobel Prizes, right? That's what it was about at that level. And how do you increase productivity? Well, the fundamental thing was interacting. They used to count how many times person A talked to person B. They even did measurements of how far people's offices were apart. They would translate how many steps sideways in a hall gave you the same level of interaction as a floor separated apart, right? That they could study, that they could track, statistically relate to research productivity. Right now, I'm as guilty as any other MSc faculty member in that we tend to stay in our own little groups and we don't really share anything like we should be. And we need to be doing that across the board for the students and student mentoring and discussing everything, and we don't. And that's a chair leadership function. That needs to be done. We talk about teaching excellence. When was the last time MSE talked about their curriculum? And it's whether or not this course was appropriate or what the content of that course should be. That's definitely important. You're not going to get to excellence without it. What about discussion review of student progress? When have we sort of shared information about how our students are doing? For example, I was talking to the students today earlier. You know, we're supposed to not just sign up to be on a committee at candidacy and then wait 6 years or 4 years and then show up at the dissertation. No, we all know that's not right. We're all supposed to be there at least. Yeah, I talk to students about, yeah, we should be, you know, getting together on a once a year basis. Two of the students were telling me, no, that's not enough. You need to do it every semester. Right? So we don't like to have a lot of meetings. I understand administrative burden. Nobody wants to do it. But for, come on, crying out loud, we need to be talking to one another. That's actually, how will I know to collaborate with Linan when I have no idea what Linan is doing? Right? That's just not going to work. So we need to do that individually. But also, the chair needs to be doing that. As chair, I can't be just electronic materials, thin film materials, Kevin anymore. No, I need to learn enough about what Linan is doing so that I can promote Linan's research and recognition for Linan's research in any venue I'm in. Same thing about Young Ho. I don't know about Jim Fenton. FSEC is pretty big and wide, but for GU, Raj, everybody in the department, not just the assistant professors, but everyone. That's the job of the chair. One of the relating to that is postdocs. Right here under research excellence, I have it there. A single PI grant is not an easy thing to put a postdoc into. Multiple PI grants, there you can fit a postdoc into the budget. Well, you're not going to get multiple PI grants unless you're actually talking to each other about doing things together. Okay. So this is really a key issue in terms of our research productivity is, you know, the chair is obviously not going to mandate collaborative things at all, but at least he needs to know and has to know what's going on, be able to suggest to person A that, oh, person B, either in the department or in a different department, is doing something that's relevant and you should have a chat with him. And this applies to service as well. We need to excel in all. So recognition, I'm basically looking for the undergraduate program to be a sort of a sudden bump in recognition. Just the announcement of it is going to gather attention through all the other materials departments in the country. The other thing you're going to have is undergraduate researchers at conferences, right? I mean, and our undergraduates continuing on to graduate study at these other schools. You know, that's how we know about them, right? Also, we need to actively market UCF and MSc at UCF, which again, this active marketing is primarily a chair responsibility. Faculty can help. I've been at conferences. It's only a 15-minute time slot for a conference, but the first slide that's shown is, I'm at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. This is a one-slide description of my department. Says five words, it takes 30 seconds, moves on. We can do that. We should be doing that. Otherwise, nobody's going to know we exist, which is our current state. Obviously, research grants and publications, you know, that's going to be how people will measure us in recognition, but we need to do much more. I mean, we're doing the research grants and publications to be 35th out of 83 in the country right now, but we're not doing the other recognition stuff. Sure, I would like the next NRC review to show us not 35th, 25th. Yes, but we need to do more. So if we look at the UCF and the college's goals to offer the best undergraduate education available in Florida, we are contributing to the mechanical engineering undergraduate education, and we should continue to do so, and we should actually have more discussions with mechanical engineering about how and why we should be doing what. You know, it's their students. We need to make sure that that happens. Achieving international prominence in key programs. I had always thought UCF is a key program. It's one of those key programs that deserves the resources, you know, MSc at UCF, that deserves the resources to move towards international prominence. And, you know, looking at our NRC ranking, it certainly must be true. Looking at our U.S. News and World Report, not so much, right? But this is where we need to, as a department, to be greater than just the sum of our current faculty, and we need more. Your international focus to curriculum and research, become more inclusive and diverse, America's leading partnership university. These, again, are all things where a chair providing active leadership can enhance our performance. Preeminence. Well, you know, improving our ranking, the undergraduate program scale, leadership, department greater than faculty, sum of faculty. These all things will help contribute here. Again, sort of research productivity of the department being sort of more than just we get there, and of course, increasing numbers will contribute here. Number of postdoctoral appointees. Well, if we were to double the faculty, we'd have twice as many, but how many do we have now? One, two? Not many. Two. Young Ho's got two. Good. But the point is that we need to be doing those collaborative proposals, those joint multi-PI proposals. We need to sort of get out of our little separate tunnel some to be able to do that. So let me switch gears and talk about me. So that was my vision. Let me talk about me. I went to high school initially in Germany as a military dependent, and then for a couple of years in Miami. I'm actually a high school dropout. My high school did not have the AP courses and the dual enrollment they have today, and by 11th grade I'd taken all the mathematics that they had to offer, pre-calculus. And so I said, enough of that. And I started working full-time, electrical supply counterman, and going part-time to school at the local community college where I could take calculus. And then I decided I wanted to move on to a full-time school. I went to a new college in Sarasota, Florida. So that is the institution that's currently a member of our state university system and is recognized as the Honors College of our state university system. At the time I was there, it was still a private school, and the year immediately after I graduated in 75, it became the Honors College of the University of South Florida, and then I think about 10 years ago or 12, it became its own institution in the SUS. So finishing college with a bachelor's degree in physics, I went and got a job as an auto mechanic. Did some semi-pro racing. I've actually road raced, 6-hour road race around Daytona, which is exciting, a fun story to tell someday. But I didn't want to be an auto mechanic after a while. I decided I was bored with that. And so I went back to school at FIU and got a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering Technology. Now, at the time, FIU was not accredited to offer a mechanical engineering degree, which is what I was thinking I should do. But they could do mechanical engineering technology. And for those of you who don't know, that's mechanical engineering without calculus. So not academically challenging, but I could say mechanical engineering technology on a resume, and that got me a position even before I finished working in product development in copiers, electrophotography. So that's the technology that's evolved to what we call laser printers today. In the old days, you actually, rather than having a laser scanner, on a photoreceptor to develop a latent electrostatic image, you would use direct imaging from your original. Maybe some of you are old enough to remember the copiers where the cover would slide back and forth. They were piecewise imaging the platen onto a rotating drum. So, I went from electrophotography to working in magnetic recording. And this actually took me from the Miami area up to the Northeast. And so started getting into hard disk drives and went back to school after a couple years part-time, did a master's degree in physics at Northeastern. All this time, I'd really sort of thought of myself as a physicist, and I finished the master's degree in the summer of 85, and across that summer I prepared for the qualifier in physics, which I'm proud to say I passed. And in that fall I started at Northeastern for one semester as a full-time graduate student in physics. And I was working with this professor, a guy by the name of Carl Schiffman, and he was interested in the two-dimensional, two-dimensional conductivity of gold films. And to do that, to make a sample, he would chill cleave mica, chill it down to 4.2 Kelvin, and evaporate a gold film on top of it, and then try to do a four-point conductance resistivity measurement. Well, he was staring at his apparatus and cursing it as he was rising it up to room temperature because one of the contacts had failed. And so I says, okay, we'll just fix the contact and you chill it back down. And he said, no, the whole film goes away. The atoms, as it's warming up to room temperature, the atoms are mobile enough that they'll move and form little balls on the mica surface, like water on a wax car. And when he said that, I was absolutely fascinated by that. That was like, wow. I mean, if you told me I annealed at 1,000 degrees C and it did that, I would believe you, but on its way up to room temperature? Yes, and sure enough, it did. But in any case, as we were standing there, I turned to him and I said, wow, why don't we study that? Because I was much more fascinated by that than I was the two-dimensional quantum conductivity of gold. And he turned to me and he sneered. And he said, that's material science. And that was the epiphany moment for Kevin, when I realized I'm not a physicist, I'm a material scientist. So that spring, I was at MIT, starting coursework and go pass another qualifier, but actually studying things that I enjoyed quite a bit more and been doing it sort of since. So I finished that PhD in 89, and I went to work in industry, so 89 through 2002. And of course, since 2002, I'm now here. And I have it colorized this way, because this is actually a slide that I used to preach lifelong learning to undergraduates. Because there's a lot of lifelong learning going on here, right? But you guys are not interested in that so much as perhaps my leadership experience over this time. So let me talk about that. Okay, so I was working as an auto mechanic. After a couple years, they made me shop foreman, assistant service manager. That's not an easy job. Nobody who walks in, this was for a dealership, Autorama, British Leyland and Mazda. Nobody walks into a dealership to bring their car to be fixed is in a good mood. They start off, they're convinced that you're a thief. And, by the way, their car's broke, so they're ticked off about that. And so balancing customers against mechanics who were doing the work was an interesting challenge. When I was at Saxon Copy Statics in Miami Lakes, working in electrophotography, again, I got promoted fairly quickly to be the manager of the chemical R&D. So they're making a photoconductive drum, and they're making it develop basically a very nice variation of the technology. This was not xerography, for those who are familiar with it, but this was actually canography, so it was a proprietary technology that Canon had started with. Then I went up to Nashua Corporation, and initially for copiers, but then spent a lot of time working on magnetic recording and disk drives, and I was made manager of a small group that was developing plated thin film media, so electroless plating of a cobalt nickel alloy as a recording media. After finishing my PhD, I went off back to IBM, where I worked as an individual contributor in the group of a fellow who was a IBM fellow, to use the word twice. And then I left there to go to Sensormatic Electronics to be the manager of their magnetic materials R&D. And that was actually a very fruitful time. I got to see a lot of patents in products. If you guys know CD cases, there's that little funny white thing that's inside almost every CD case you'll ever buy. Side boxes at Home Depot. It's the Sensormatic anti-theft technology. So I didn't invent it, but I've had the pleasure of extending the life of their patent-based monopoly. So was there, and then Seagate Technology hired me to be a director, so a second line manager in their magneto-optic disk development. So they had bought a startup by the name of Quinta that you may have heard of, and they were involved in, within their disk factory, coming up with the suitable media for it. And after I was there approximately a year, a little less, and came back to IBM, where I was manager in the disk development engineering. And of course, in my academic career, I've been the founding chair of MSC. So a lot of experience and time at first level managing, which is herding cats, right? There's a lot of different ways to call it. But I've had a lot of success and a lot of satisfaction at it. But now as a researcher, who I am is thin film materials. So my doctorate at the time, MIT, segregated into different sections. I wasn't a physical metallurgist. I was an electronic materials person. And I've continued that interest in the thin film materials, looking at metals, obviously magnetic metals you might think of as electronic materials. But it turns out, we'll talk about it, that metals, just the conductivity when they're at the nanoscale, is a huge and interesting problem. I got into this because when I was in industry, I had done work on giant magnetoresistance, which is a spin-dependent scattering. You know, there's magnetic materials magnetized north and something else is south. When they share electrons, they scatter a lot more and get a higher resistivity than if they're both magnetized north. Okay. So that's the essence of giant magnetoresistance. It's considered a spin-dependent effect. And in trying to sort of launch an understanding of that in an academic context as compared to an industrial, I discovered that it wasn't really well understood. And so I started looking at a simpler problem, that is electrons scattering at a metal dielectric interface. And that is also not really well understood. And that's a much more important problem because that is central to modern computing. Okay, for those of you that are old enough, you remember that we used to double the speed of our processors every so often, right? Then about 10 years ago, it stopped. Reason is, RC time constant of the wires between the transistors. And what's happening is a very old effect. When metals get thin, the scattering from the surfaces increases resistivity. So this is the classical size effect. So obviously, if I kill the cross-section by a factor of 2, the resistance should go up by a factor of 2, but the resistance goes up more than a factor of 2 because the resistivity itself has gone up. This is the key issue for power consumption in modern computing and in computing speed, the resistance of the wires. I mean, I told you there are 3 billion transistors on a chip, you believe me? Now I'm talking about the 9 billion wires on the chip, because each transistor is a three-wire device. So that's a very important problem, and I'll talk about in detail about that. But I've done other things with, ordering of intermetallic nanoparticles, semiconductors, VO2, amorphous IR sensors, energy, lithium solid-state battery electrolytic materials, and energetics. An interesting phenomenon, I can make a layer of aluminum and a layer of cobalt oxide. They will react, burn very quickly, leaving alumina and copper. And that has some interesting applications as well. So this is kind of work that I'm proud of. This is a PhysRev-B 2010, and this is talking about this resistivity size effect, where as the copper layer gets thinner, the resistivity goes up, right? You know, bulk copper has a resistivity room temperature 1.7 microohms centimeters. This is the room temperature data. Down here is liquid helium data, 4.2 Kelvin. And this type of thing had been done forever. And there's a FS, is Fuchsenheimer surface scattering model. And you can see that, you know, there's quite a bit of scatter for the same layer thickness, right? Not really a good fit over here. This had been done, and Fuchsenheimer came out in their stuff in the 30s and 50s. This had never been done. This is the same resistivity data points. But what's been done is, for the film, the copper grain size has been accurately measured. This was the first time anybody ever plotted resistivity versus grain size. Lo and behold, a lot of that scatter goes away, because the fundamental mechanism is not electron scattering from surfaces. No, electron scattering at grain boundaries. Right. And so that was a neat contribution to the field. Grain boundaries are bad. Modern copper interconnects are fit into small lines, and the narrower the lines are, the smaller the grains, the more grain boundaries. So it's a big issue. Now, to do that was not easy. I think Dr. Son will recall a student named Bo Yao, who was in my group for a while. And he developed a variation on a TEM contrast technique. So it's not bright field, it's not dark field. It's an annular dark field technique where he takes the aperture and scans it around a ring. So you get a lot of different shades of gray. But you still don't have something that a computer can decide what the grain size is, right? This is copper, and these funny lines are twins, and I'll talk about those in a sec. So what he did was to take an image, put a transparency on top of it, and hand trace the grain boundaries, okay? And that would result in something that looked like this, which could be fed into a computer for automated image analysis to get average grain size and grain size distribution. That paper I showed you consisted of 22 different samples for which 19,144 grains were hand traced. That's a student. Actually, over the course of this, he did probably closer to 24,000 grains, because not everything was, you know, done right the first time. Okay, now there are more modern techniques recently developed. This one we don't have at UCF. This is precession electron diffraction. But what we do have at UCF is electron backscatter diffraction. But the basic idea is I can come in with a TEM and I can do an electron diffraction from that one spot and decide what the orientation of that crystal is at that spot. And then I can step over an array of all of the spots and decide what the crystal orientations are. And they're colorized in this map here. So blue is 111 coming out, red is 001, green is 101. So they're colorized here. And so these linear streaky features are twins. I don't know if you guys know what a twin is, but in a crystal, if you have a 111 plane and you rotate the two halves of the crystal relative to one another by 60 degrees, it introduces a type of crystalline defect that's called a twin. And FCC metals are very prone to that. So this is precession electron diffraction. Is something that we definitely want to get here. What I thought was cool about it is that since you know the orientation of the two grains, you always know whether it's a twin orientation. But it turned out, in my own mind, naively, I thought every twin occurred in a 111 plane. And actually, it's not true. When it does occur along a 111 plane, you call it a coherent twin. And the coherent twins are the thick black lines in these images. But you can actually have the twin orientation between the grains, but have the plane between the grains be something else than a 111. And those are incoherent twins, and they're shown as these red lines. The light dark lines are just the general grain boundaries. But given that grain boundary scattering is bad for interconnect resistivity, we started working on single crystal tungsten films. Single crystal films, tungsten was of interest because it's a lot more stable than copper. So a simple measurement, four-point resistance measurement of a small nanowire, it turns out that we had a choice of which crystallographic direction in the plane to orient the nanowire, right? And why would that matter? Well, it turns out metals are kind of complicated physics devices. Okay, the Drude model of electrical conductivity assumes a spherical Fermi surface, but that's not what really happens. I'm running low on time, so let me perhaps move along. This is just details of the e-beam lithography preparing the lines. What we did is for each orientation make a series of lines where we went very wide, 450 nanometers wide, all the way down to as narrow as we could get, 15 nanometers. And then you measure the resistivity as they become narrower. Classical size effect says it should go up. And it did. We also made some films with polycrystalline lines just for comparison, right? And the two processes were used. And what came out of that, and this is both patented as well as published, was that along the preferred direction, which is the 111, the increase in resistivity as you narrowed the lines was half of what it was along the other directions. So the resistivity size effect has a crystallographic anisotropy. Now, cubic systems are supposed to be isotropic, and they are in bulk, but not when it comes down to nanoscale things where I'm less than bulk, right? Keep in mind that mean free paths are 19 nanometers. So as I start squeezing down to where would be the mean free path for phonon scattering, strange stuff happens. This is kind of the explanation we have of it, is this is the Fermi surface for tungsten. It has E areas that are both electron-like and hole-like. I know we think of electron and holes of only applying to semiconductors, not so. Metals can have electrons and holes. And the hole octahedra in particular has a Fermi velocity, right? In other words, keep in mind, I know we have this idea that electrons move with the field, but the reality is they're quantum mechanical devices. They're moving about 1,000 times faster than that all the time. And that field-induced velocity is just a small perturbation. So that Fermi velocity is about 3 times higher on 111 than it is along 100 or 110. So what that means is that the mean free path is longer along 111. Right? So if you're going to narrow the wire, you don't want to do it along 111. You want to do as much as possible along the other guys, which is what these arrows here are representing, is the length of those little arrows you see in the middle of those three colored bars indicating the different orientations. Those are drawn proportional to the Fermi velocity. And I get more if I orient along the length. So, you know, this was ongoing work. This is just some Fermi surfaces. This is copper, which looks kind of spherical, which is, you know, the simple model everybody gets taught. But ruthenium, rhodium, moly, so HCP, FCC, and BCC crystal structures, real metals are much more complex in terms of their Fermi surface. So this is really a material science, physics crossover type of work. We recently got a paper submitted to a joint NSF-SRC call with five PIs out of UCF, me and Dr. Zhang at NSE, and two out of Columbia, one at MIT, one at RPI, one at Stanford. So we'll see how that goes. But what we're really trying to do there is break past this resistivity size effect to where we just get, you know, the wire gets small enough, becomes quantum mechanically one-dimensional along the axis, and now that changes the scattering rules altogether because there are only finite states in those directions, and we're trying to get ballistic conduction. Okay, so my final slide is why K.R. Coffee is MSE chair. Okay, I gave you a view of my research. I'm not the strongest MSE researcher. You know, I would think Dr. Sohn or Dr. Seals, Pegasus professors, in terms of the dollar values and the research expenditures, these are clearly the strongest guys. But I would argue that you don't want your strongest researcher as chair. Certainly within the culture of IBM and their management strategies, that was the worst thing you could ever do, because then you sort of shot him in the head as far as being a researcher, and he's probably not necessarily a good administrator either, right? So that's not really a good strategy in general, right? Every case is unique. But I'm not the strongest researcher. So let me just say that right off the bat. I do have extensive leadership experience, and especially at this thing of making the department work together so that it's greater than just the sum of the faculty. Your faculty don't want to be viewed as just a dollar contribution to the annual research expenditures tally, right? And they aren't just that. They're much more than that. They want to be more than that. And that's how they are engaged and motivated. And then sort of my final bullet here is I'm able and willing to formally commit to this task. You know, this is not a job for part-time, not if you actually want to go anywhere as a department. This is something that it is a full-time commitment, and that's what I want to do. So I'm going to stop there, and hopefully I've left time for questions.
Are there any questions for Dr. Cohen? Yes. I got to ask the science question, or the pure science question.
Why does gold do that?
Because it's a problem for all sorts of things, and also kind of useful for some for cosmonics.
Yeah. Well. I think some of the plasmonics applications would help by alloying, because this is work that I did with Dave Shelton. And it's his publication mostly, but the conductivity is not simple at those frequencies. And it turns out that what would be a normal scattering bad thing, alloying, turns out to be good at plasmonics. At least that's how I understood it from Dave. So let me say that you shouldn't be using gold, pure gold anyway, right? But why does gold do that? Gold is a noble metal and non-reactive. So its ability to chemically react or bond in any way, shape, or form with mica is pretty much zilch. And at the same time, it's FCC, So any tendency for the atoms to move, to increase surface areas of 111 crystal faces, they will. That's a phenomenon known as faceting, and so they're going to try to do that, and they're going to try to reduce their surface energy. And you know, the energy to volume ratio for a sphere is just a whole lot better than the energy to volume ratio for a sheet, and it's really that simple. Well, I've been able, you know, I'm interested in single crystal ruthenium. Ruthenium is HCP, and ruthenium has close packed planes that are only in one crystal direction. So, for instance, if you make ruthenium so that it is OO2 oriented, so if you make ruthenium such that this would be the C-axis would be up, and this is the would be the OO2 plane here, that is the lowest surface energy plane in terms against faceting. And so if you actually make that, that's relatively stable. You know, the nature of the instabilities are essentially Rayleigh instabilities. So you guys all know that if you turn on the water, you get a solid stream, but if you turn the water down, as the stream gets narrower and narrower, it starts breaking up into droplets. Okay, that's what we call a Rayleigh instability. So that's actually what breaks up, you know, that's the phenomena of the gold film breaking up. Not in a one-dimensional, but in a two-dimensional fashion.
As long as you got this slide up, all the activities. I'm not going to ask a science question. My question is, using all the things you explained about why you're qualified, why you're doing. Explain to me your role as far as putting that team together that you put up there. Do you exhibit any of those skills you shared with us doing that?
Yeah, I would say I have. Gall was a competitor of mine for many years. And I managed to bring him in as a collaborator in here. And actually, a very strong collaboration now. He's really good. I like him. Barmak, I went to grad school with, okay? Same time as Jay Hickman was there, right? If you want to go back in history. West is her colleague there. Thompson was on my PhD committee when I was at MIT. He's pretty much the morphology. In other words, if you really want to make a 2-nanometer wire, you have to worry about Rayleigh instabilities. And he's done some early work in that. And so he's on here to help us fully understand, because if it's going to be an interconnect, it better be stable, right? Wonderful conduction. That does not an interconnect make, not if it's not stable. And, you know, we're also working on an ERC idea, which will impact some of the people over in Creole, because you know people are using these nanoscale metal structures for metamaterials, trying to make them smaller and smaller. And our abilities nowadays with e-beam patterning and other things, and the latest thing is the helium ion beam direct write, right? Our ability to make things is much greater than our ability for these things to actually be stable. Notice you can make fine structures and then at room temperature, just like the gold, they'll just go away, right? And so you have to understand now the faceting, the crystallography. Typically, interconnects are encapsulated in dielectric, so that obviously impacts their stability, and that's an area that is, you know, grossly understudied. So that's overlapping in the world of mechanical as well.
So if Kevin Coffey became the chair,
there's somebody else. I just want to make sure that I didn't ignore them, and we'll get to you next.
Oh, okay. So Kevin Coffey became a chair and worked as a chair for 5 years. 5 years from now, and you were trying to get the faculty to buy in for another 5 years. In 5 years, what would you accomplish that really benchmarks your accomplishment as a chair? What would you like to accomplish in 5 years?
Well, I mean,
three, let's say.
So in 5 years, we should have an undergraduate program that's growing and healthy. in 5 years, we should, I'm trying to find out where it would be best, we should have a lot more postdocs than we have today. You know, obviously, I'm not going to be, writing budgets for people's research, but it's a matter of encouraging people to consider putting a postdoc in if they can. It's a matter of trying to get people to come in with, you know, larger multi-PI proposals that'll fit postdocs. So, yeah, I mean, the undergraduate, and then finally, recognition. You know, I think we want to be recognized by U.S. News and World Reports at that same level that I feel that we are excellent. Yeah, I mean, that's, and you know, how many faculty we can grow to, I don't know. Yes?
Yeah, I had a question about that student that did the diagram, the Venn diagram of the structure. And when I was looking at the picture, I said, you know, that really called out for computer vision.
And yeah.
I knew Mubarak Shah has done work with computer vision with electron microscopes in MIT. Have you all worked together at all?
I have not worked with Mubarak on this, but this is a long-standing problem that many material scientists have worked on. My one collaborator, Dr. Barmak, has had a lot of efforts and achieved partial success with aluminum thin films, right? But no success with copper, because copper has this complicated twin structure, and that makes it very, very difficult to assess, you know, what is a grain, what is not a grain. So have not tried with Mubarak. Right now, sort of the technology has moved past that, because instead of just recognizing what a grain is, you know, there's this precession electron diffraction technique, which is even more powerful, which actually tells us at that spot, at that particular pixel, what is the orientation of the crystal. And that's really cool.
Well, I'm just saying, it's from a computer science standpoint.
Right.
And I can only talk from that perspective. This is sort of really screams machine learning techniques, well, to help
you know,
find what's going on.
I did not talk to Mubarak about that, and that's something that I had not.
How do you incorporate multidisciplinary in material science? I'll be honest, working on the Army Science Board, material science is going way down on the scale of priorities, mainly because there's a lot of people who believe that it's just a rut right now. That there's not a lot of great progress being made. And I don't really, I understand it from an academic perspective, you may see great changes going on, but from the folks who are funding material science, they don't see it that way. They've been trying to figure out how to make unobtainium and impervium for a long time, and they're just not making a lot of progress right now. And they keep pushing those programs down the road. Where is the next, you know, when you say this is, where are we going to energize material science? Sorry, that's a super big question.
No, and I think it's a fair question. You know, I started off in physics, so the reason I liked physics is, unlike chemistry, I didn't have to memorize anything. I just had to understand it. So if you could do the math, then you could do the physics. But material science was interesting to me because it's where you could understand, but not predict, right? Now, what's happening in the overall is we can now do configurational models of chemistry to where predicting chemical reactions is now not a problem to a large extent. So computer science is having a huge impact. Now, it isn't quite there yet in material science, but it's getting to be there. There are techniques such as phase field modeling and what's called multi-scale modeling. The problem with material science is that and I'm working with, you know, in terms of that team, just to sort of let you, you know, try to give you an answer. So Musciolo and Sheng are in physics, and what they're doing is first principle models, where they're basically taking
tight binding approximation for individual atoms and doing every atom in the nanowire, okay, to be able to understand the conductivity and the quantum confinement issues and be able to include things like defects. Notice they might have a perfect crystal plane, but oh, I got a step. Or maybe entropy, we know, loves to give us disorder in this world. Maybe I have a perfect crystal plane, but one of the atoms is out of the top and sitting over there. So that would be a point defect. So all these things have to be included to try to really, you know, get to real properties. It's difficult to span all the length scales. They think they have a unique technique that, I guess, where the computational overheads, and this is past my understanding as a computer scientist by far, but the computational overhead scales is just the number of atoms, rather than going as the number of atoms squared, which I guess is matrix inversion or something. I'm just repeating words I don't understand. So people are applying that. It's not quite there yet. Computing's not quite there yet. But pretty soon it will be. And that is, you know, design of materials, computational design of materials, is the new major area. So experimentalists will be needed to confirm things and to refine models, but that's where things are going. And so that's my idea of the new frontier.
I'm going to have to call time so we can stay on our schedule, but please join me in thanking Dr. Coffey. And thank you all for being here. Your next appointment is with Dr. Adi and Dr. Pellis. They're ready to go.